Okay, so I think we can start with the session now. Right. So welcome everyone. I'm Ashwin. I work with C2 Sapling Education, and yeah, I'm happy to welcome you all to the second edition of the Teachers Corner. So this Teachers Corner, we came up with this idea to create a space for teachers to exchange ideas. And we met last month, and we want to make this a regular monthly meeting where we meet teachers of different kinds with different ideas. And let me give a quick introduction of myself. So my name is Ashwin. I have finished my PhD in computer science from IISc, Indian Institute of Science in Bangalore. And I was interested in teaching math to students when I was doing my PhD, and now I have taken up as my full-time job. So I work with schools and school teachers, and I try to teach maths in a different or more interesting way for the students. And I teach for primary and middle school. With me, we have this we have a team also from a research background. We are part of, we make up this team of C2 Sapling. And yeah, so I want to make one thing very clear. Today, this session is not about any one person communicating their ideas, trying to change the minds of other people. We want to make this as a space for dialogue, that is where people talk to each other. And this session, the aim of this session is not for me to say something new to you, but it's just to hear from you also, and to have teachers communicate with each other. So we welcome new views, we welcome different points of view, different arguments, and so on. So this is a place where there is no preaching, there's no judgment. So along with the message that we sent you earlier, we had also sent a link to a Padlet where we asked you some questions. That is, what is the purpose of teaching, for example? And we got some responses. So maybe I will share the responses with you now. So if possible, I would like those who have entered some of their ideas in the Padlet to maybe elaborate a little bit. So let me share my screen. Right, so I hope the screen is visible to everyone. Right. We had asked three questions. One was, how would you measure your subject? That is, what would be the criteria to say that this is a good concept, or this is a very useful concept in your subject? Another question was, what would you consider to be the best achievement of your subject? So this Teacher's Corner, it's not subject specific, it's not grade specific, it's not curriculum specific either. So it is for all teachers across different classes, across different boards, and across different subjects. So we wanted to hear from you, what would you consider to be the highest pinnacle of your subject? And also, why do you teach your subject? I'm assuming that you all like your subject and you enjoy teaching it, but what is the reason that you have for teaching your subject? Here, of course, we would love to hear from you in this Zoom, because we are having this meeting online and there are many participants. In order to maybe communicate smoothly, it will be better if you use the raise hand feature. So Zoom gives you the feature to raise hand. There maybe I will allow you to unmute yourself, and you can speak so that we don't have many people talking at the same time. Right. So I'm eager to hear from you. Would you like to elaborate on what you have mentioned in the Padlet? Shantipriya ma'am, I can see that you have posted a couple of your ideas on the Padlet. So, would you like to elaborate on them?
Yeah. So how do you measure your subject? because I'm dealing with STEM, where is an interdisciplinary. So we have an experiential learning classroom where there are different tools and instructions that have been given to students so that they use these instructions to make there will be a model that they have to add a project that they will make. Okay. So let me say, if there is a robotics class, then usually we will give the tools and there are guided instructions one after the other. So the students will follow what to be attached and how to program it and they'll learn it. So after end of these two projects, we will usually give a capstone for them. There is a problem, a real time life problem that will be given to them. Mm-hmm. And then they had to take the help of their previous knowledge. Mm-hmm. And it is a certain guidelines from the teachers also. It's only facilitation. Mm-hmm. And then they will come, they'll build a solution.
Okay.
So wherein they will usually use the design thinking process.
Mm-hmm.
So the defining, ideating. So we look at the majorly, at because the problem is already defined, we look at how they are able to draw the solution, how the ideation process is happening, and how far, how many groups of the students have come up to the design stage. Because building is easier, but coming from ideating to designing is really difficult because they have to find the better solution for the given problem. So usually we will look at the how they are writing those steps. What are the solutions? Are they feasible? Are it actually aligned to the problem or not? Are you deviating from this? So that's what we look at. So during the assessment, I mean, this is a part of the assessment, the design thinking process is a part of our assessment,
mm-hmm.
wherein we observe the students, the group of students actually, individually as well as a group,
mm-hmm.
and then we'll identify who is actually participating, who is communicating better, who is designing, who is writing the writing the solution. So there are different parts in it. So how who is collaborating well with the group, and who actually leading the group? These are the things what we observe, and then these will be assessed based on that on a scale of 1 to 4, like where 1 starts from like beginner, developing, and then accomplished. Then expertise. So these are the things. So we are not giving any grade or there are marks for the students, but only based on our observation, as well as we also give the students to assess themselves when they're working on the problem. So they will comment on what they have learned and what is the skill they developed during this whole process, how well they were able to collaborate, and is this their idea, and how they were able to draw the solution, how much they enjoyed doing these things and all. So that is and also a peer assessment. So in this, we are not actually judging the students individually, but we are telling that, okay, you are good with these things and you had to develop or work on these different things.
Just want to clarify one thing. So I can understand that you are talking about the assessment part. And your explanation is how you assess the students. But my question was actually, how will you assess the subject? So for example, go ahead.
So the thing is, so here we are looking, when I'm teaching robotics, I look at the output of the students, finally what they have done. The group is done, it's not an individual. Okay, the group is done, and if the output is really good, then that means, and it is aligned to the solution. Sometimes they might give a different solution, which is a really innovative, which we never thought of, that they will come up with a different model. Okay, so we will look at the output, what they have given, and what are the problem, what is given. So we will compare these two and say that, okay, how many groups of children are able to solve the problem? That is one way where we will. So if the output is really good and all, so that's where that my instructions or the guidelines or the facilitation, whatever we have done, it is successful.
Okay.
And most of the groups have failed, then maybe we had to review ourselves how we are facilitating. So because it is interdisciplinary. Okay, and what is the best piece of work? So I already told the ideation, the solutions, what the students give and how they design it. Mm-hmm. It's not actually the build. It's more of designing the solutions, what they find, and also the designing part of it, how better they could draw that solution into which they can make into a model. That's where the best piece of work, we actually send it to the parents also. So they're published that this is the solution, what these the student groups have done it. Okay, so and the third one is why teach your subject. As I said, it is interdisciplinary. We are not focusing. So we are looking at the all the skills. I mean, all the maybe maths, physics are a set of things that we do, and also English because they have to communicate. So I do believe that, and this class is like, they don't have everyday class. It is weekly one class where we are teaching this to them. So I do look at that these things, they'll able to understand that at certain point of time when they are designing solutions or finding any problem, it could be any problem in their life also, there they had to apply the knowledge of different things. It's just not one. That means if I'm going to say I want to make a table, but I just don't need just a wood. I need also measurements. I also should know the angles into how I had to fix it. So because we are now teaching them as a different subjects, just for their understanding, that for a deeper understanding of the subject, we are teaching them differently. But at some point of time, when you are finding solutions, there is an integration. It is mandatory for us to apply the knowledge of different subjects.
Okay.
So that's why I feel so they should have this class or the subject, the integration of subjects is called STEM or STEAM. Even art also included in this now. So I feel it is mandated to at least to for the children to experience what exactly is it.
Yeah, thank you for your ideas, ma'am. Because I think the power just went off. Yeah. Just give me 1 second. I will set up my lighting here. I really I'm sorry for that. There was a little bit of an interruption. Yeah, I'm glad that you mentioned this, that is subject integration, because I think it's very important for teachers not to look at a subject in a silo, but have this cross-disciplinary approach to education. I would love to hear from one of you again on your thoughts on how do you measure your subject? That is, what would be the criteria to say that this is the good part of my subject and so on? I would love to hear from one of you. So would any of you like to share your thoughts?
Ashwin, if I may, I'm not able to raise hand here.
But anyway, fine. You can go ahead.
Yeah, thank you. I'm sorry that Teachers for Teachers community is mine. And I've used another ID for that. I'm so sorry.
That's okay. Sure.
If you think about how do you measure your subject, and if your question is like, why that content, right? Why do we choose to teach that content? Or how do you do that? Is first to look at the batch that you have. What is my understanding is, like, if I'm teaching a batch of 40 students, it was also always going to be different from the prior 40 or the upcoming 40 kids that I'm going to have, because there's going to be individual differences. There's going to be multiple intelligences in my classroom. So the content would also depend and on what level, learning level my child is on, most of them. And also on how ready are they, the readiness of them to learn that content. So the even if it is life cycle of, I'm going to choose, I am a primary class teacher, so I would choose a very basic thing. If it's about life cycle of a tree or a plant, I would actually see how much they are able to relate with it, how much they are ready to learn, and then choose from where to pick up. Right? Even if it is grade 3, then you need to be ready to learn. So the readiness is one. Then you have to prepare your content delivery according to how your class is balanced. Like, you know, you have to cater to all learning types that you have, learning styles. That is another part. And also, because as teachers, we have been given some learning outcomes that you have to achieve. So you have to get that far, right? So that's one. So we always take diagnostic assessment before we start our class. So that diagnostic assessment, once you get that, you get out different kind of things. You know, you apply a rubric to it. And then you get, okay, we have to start from, might be, you have to start from third level. And then you will be able to reach to the first level of what you're going to teach now. So that would be my how of it. And your second question was the piece of...
what would you consider the best piece of your subject?
So if I may say, like, if I'm teaching them phonics, right, that would be application of how they're able to relate it to the real life, or we teach them different tricks of sounds instead of words. So how they're able to catch it up, or how they're able to apply and they're able to understand the better working of it, right? Because the entire education that we're trying to give or conceive is totally upon how much they are able to apply it instead of remembering it. So it totally depends how much they are able to take within. Let's say it is not only for the examination and then the entire knowledge just flushes out in the toilet after the next exam, right? So it has how much they actually acquire of it and they're able to apply for the understanding of the better next content that they're going to learn. That. And the third one was, I'm sorry, very bad.
Why do you teach your subject?
Yeah, so I actually teach English. I'm a primary, so we have mother teachers. So we teach English, EVS, and mathematics. Yeah. So it is like, because I'm teaching grade 2 and 3, and they need one teacher assistance. So that is why we teach the subject. But if you tell me to choose, the one that I'm teaching is English. That's my core subject, English math. So that would be because it's a language. English is a language. Mathematics is science. And then science is the basic nature of everything around. Right. So as I wrote, it's an amalgamation of, like, you know, even if it's language, it has science in it. Maths has language in it. Science has mathematics in it. It's called integration, again, how Santhi ma'am said. Right.
Yeah. Thanks for sharing your thoughts. Would anyone else also like to share their thoughts? You can use the raise hand feature, or you can unmute and you can speak if you want. Right. So thanks, Deepali and Shantipriya, for sharing your thoughts. Right. So today, what we thought of doing was, I wanted to share this book, which I came across a few years back. And I just wanted to share about why we teach a particular subject. So again, one of the very common responses that I hear from a lot of teachers is, the students are not learning. That's a very general statement, but one of the more specific issues that teachers often have is, the students don't realize the importance of what we are giving them. You are teaching them something which is very useful, which is valuable, and that's how, as teachers, that's how we feel that what we are doing is very important for us, and it's for their own importance. It's going to help them in the future. But the children, they are not paying attention. They are taking it too lightly. They're not listening in class. They're doing something else. So this is something that every teacher has experienced, and this is not subject specific. It's not like students love this particular subject and hate all the other subjects. That depends on the interest of the student, of course. Maybe it could happen that some topics are more interesting in a particular subject, but I would be really surprised, and I would like really be have my mind blown if any teacher could claim that 100% of my class, 100% of the students listen and pay attention 100% of the time. So no teacher I have come across ever has ever achieved this kind of super 100% success rate. So I just wanted to share this book, which talks about this problem, and it also gives a sort of solution for this. So I teach maths. I have a background in computer science, and that involves a lot of math. It involves a lot of skills that are developed in maths. So that is my that is the description of my love for maths, you could say. So this book, which I just wanted to kind of read out a little bit, this book reading that we will do, it's the book is called Mathematician's Lemon, but I feel it is applicable for all educators. So this book is written by Paul Lockhart. Maybe I'll just share my screen. Just give me one second to set up the slides. Yeah, I think we're ready. I hope the screen is visible to everyone. Right. So today, I just wanted to introduce this book, Mathematician's Lemon, to all of you. This book is written by Paul Lockhart. Paul Lockhart was a proper researcher. He was a proper working mathematician working in a university. And he developed a love for teaching math to school students. So he started teaching maths to school students from basically kindergarten up till class 12, so K to 12. In the American system. And he wrote an essay in, I think around 2004 or so, where he kind of, the title practically gives it away, where he kind of laments about the education system, especially when teaching math. And that essay kind of gained a little bit of a cult following within the math teaching community in the US. And later it's become famous worldwide. So there he talks about the problems math education faces. It's not specifically to the student, it's not specifically about a topic or a grade or a teacher or a school, but the whole system of math education together. He kind of discusses the problems that are there in the system, and he also gives some of the solutions in the second half of the book. Just to give like a small tidbit about this, Mathematician's Lemon is actually a kind of play on words. So there was this essay called Mathematician's Apology, written by G. Hardy. So this Hardy is the famous collaborator of Ramanujan. He was a professor of maths in Oxford, I think, Oxford or Cambridge, one of those. And he was a proper theoretical mathematician. He would like to call himself pure mathematician, that is pure, unsullied by application in the real world. So this mathematician, he wrote a very poetic essay about why mathematicians do whatever they do. So that was called Mathematician's Apology. And later, there was another book called Mathematician's Delight. This was again written by another math educator, where he talks about why math is so wonderful. So this book, Mathematician's Lemon, it's actually a kind of homage to those two earlier works, The Mathematician's Apology and The Mathematician's Delight. Maybe I'll share the link to those works also earlier, those works which came earlier after this meeting. Right. So I just want to read or just give the prelude of this book, Mathematician's Lemon. I'll share my screen. I'll share the book with you. Right. I hope the screen is visible. I will we'll just spend maybe 5 or 10 minutes reading just the first few pages of this book. I will share my screen so you can read it out, and yeah, I'll also read it out loud. But yeah, if you want to read it quietly, it's okay. You can just mute me and just look at the screen and you can read it. Right. So the scenario is this. You have a musician who wakes up from a nightmare. And what happened in his nightmare was this. It is when the education system starts teaching the music. Right. So before I share the book, the actual book with you, I just want to give you the setting. That is, there is a musician, and he wakes up from the nightmare where the society, where the most powerful people, the politicians, the industrialists, the parents, the whole society decides that music is very important, and we should teach music to the future of humanity. That is, we should teach music to our children, and because it's so beautiful, we should teach them at an early age. And they go about teaching music in a particular way. And the opening of this book is just describing how to teach music. Right, so let me just read out at least maybe the first two pages of this book. Right, a musician wakes up from a terrible nightmare. In his dream, he finds himself in a society where music education has been mandatory. We are helping our students become more competitive in an increasingly sound-filled world. Educators, school systems, and the state are put in charge of this vital project. Studies are commissioned, committees are formed, and decisions are made, all without the advice or participation of a single working musician or composer. Since musicians are known to set down their ideas in the form of sheet music, which are these curious black dots and lines which constitute the language of music, it is imperative that students become fluent in this language if they are to attain any degree of musical competence. Indeed, it would be ludicrous to expect a child to sing a song or play an instrument without having a thorough grounding in music notation and theory. Playing and listening to music, let alone composing an original piece, are considered very advanced topics and are generally put off until college and more often graduate school. As for the primary and secondary schools, their mission is to train students to use this language, to jiggle symbols around according to a fixed set of rules. Music class is where we take out our staff paper, our teacher puts some notes on the board, and we copy them or transpose them into a different key. We have to make sure to get the clefs and the key signatures right. And our teacher is very picky about making sure that we fill in our quarter notes completely. One time we had a chromatic scale problem and I did it right. But the teacher gave me no credit because I had the stems pointing the wrong way. In their wisdom, educators soon realized that even very young children can be given this kind of musical instruction. In fact, it is considered quite shameful if one's third grader hasn't completely memorized his circle of fifths. I have to get my son a music tutor. He simply won't apply himself to his music homework. He says it's boring. He just sits there staring out the window, humming tunes to himself and making up silly songs. In higher grades, the pressure is really on. After all, the students must be prepared for standardized tests and college admission exams. Students must take courses in scales and modes, meter, harmony, and counterpoint. It's a lot for them to learn, but later in college, when they finally get to hear all this stuff, they'll really appreciate all the work they did in high school. Of course, not many students actually go on to concentrate in music. So only a few will ever get to hear the sounds that the black dots represent. Nevertheless, it is important that every member of society be able to recognize a modulation or a fugal passage, regardless of the fact that they will never hear one. To tell the truth, most students aren't very good at music. They're just bored in class, their skills are terrible, and their homework is barely legible. Most of them couldn't care less about how important music is in today's world. They just want to take the minimum number of music courses and be done with it. I guess there are just music people and non-music people. I had this one kid though. She was sensational. Her sheets were impeccable, every note in the right place, perfect calligraphy, sharps, flats, just beautiful. She was going to make one hell of a musician someday. And this musician wakes up from his dream. Waking up in a cold sweat, the musician realizes gratefully that it was all just a crazy dream. Of course, he reassures himself. No society would ever reduce such a beautiful and meaningful art form to something so mindless and trivial. No culture could be so cruel to its children as to deprive them of such a natural, satisfying means of human expression. How absurd. Meanwhile, on the other side of a town, a painter has just awakened from a similar nightmare. Right, so I will just stop here. Maybe I'll just give you a minute to scroll through this passage. Yeah, the end quote. I like painting, one of the students remarked. They tell me what to do and I do it. It's easy. After the class, I spoke with the teacher. So your students don't actually do any painting? I asked. Well, next year they take pre-paint by numbers, the teacher replied. Okay, so I just want to hear from you. What do you think of teaching music this way, where the students are trained in the notation, in understanding how the chromatic scale works, in understanding all the different aspects, all the different theories behind music. And when they are mature enough, you allow them to play a tune or allow them to compose the music. So I'm just kind of curious to know what would be your approach to teach music, or would you agree with this approach? It's okay if you're not a music teacher. I'm not a music teacher either. I'm just interested in the teaching aspect of it. How do you think we will go about teaching music? So yeah, I mean, you can unmute yourself and you can share your thoughts.
Hi, Ashwin, I'll speak again.
Yeah, sure, go ahead.
According to my understanding, how would we know whether we like it or not until unless we have explored it, right? Mm. So if there's a teaching of only the mechanism of it, just knowing what to do, will not help me or my kids to understand whether they really like to do it or not, right? Would it be a reality? As that kid in the end, you know, when he said he liked painting because it's easy to do, not because he understands, you know, what exactly it is. Or if you talk about music, you know, music is something that it heals. It automatically comes, you know, you love the notations, you love what you hear, and there are different type of instruments. Somebody would like trumpet and somebody would like guitar. But unless you try and you explore it, everything at a basic level, there's no point of going ahead with it. And if you learn mechanism, I think, according to me, mechanism should come at the last part of it. Right? You learn how to build a sand castle at a beach and then you become an architect. You don't learn how to scale on a sand beach and then, you know, get all this structure there and then learn how to do it. So that's what I think of.
Okay, just to see if I've understood you clearly. To summarize your point is that the students, the children should experience the subject, they should experience the music, should try out different instruments before they decide whether they like it or not. And if they like, then you can tell them the mechanism of music, right?
Sure.
Yeah, would anyone else like to share their thoughts?
Yeah. So if, as she said, music is like, it's a inherent talent what students will have it. So in schools also, if you see, it is an optional. It's not mandatory that every child should attend. So they are being given different options for them, which subjects they would like to or which arts they would like to, and then they get in. So even after joining the class also, some of the students say, if I'm teaching a guitar class, okay, some of them might only get to know the notes and all, the beat, these things and all, they learn faster. And then those children will engage themselves in trying it out. So when you're teaching, it's mostly the as a music teacher, if I'm a music teacher, then usually you tell them the basics, the notes and how to beat, how to get the beat and what things you have to and what sound you will get and all. Then probably once they start trying it, all the theory part will come later. Because once you start giving them the theory, children will lose interest. They don't even try to experiment with the tool. Okay, experiment with the instrument. So that is where all they lose their interest, and also because it's related to heart. So because once you start music, playing music, it's what you're expressing your thoughts, your emotions through music. Okay, that has to come when the child feels it. So that's where giving a theory, I don't find that there's no meaning in, especially in the lower grade. And if they're actually going for like an exam and all, where they want to, then probably this will do it. Because the theory part, it will give a different, visualization for them. How actually these, they have come up and these things. So maybe if they want to give some exam and all, yeah. But if I want to learn music, now at this age, if I want to learn music, it's for my pleasure. I do express myself. It's not I wanted to learn all the theory and all. So as a music teacher in the classroom, I don't find any meaning. And I don't say not meaning, but in the beginning, maybe at least when still the children understand what exactly they want it and they involve themselves, then probably you can give them the theory.
To summarize what you said, you feel that theory is something that they can be given if they are serious about it later, after they have kind of got some mastery of a little bit of taste of the subject. If they want, then you can give them the theory of music. But until then, music is mostly about expression. And it's something they do for pleasure, right? Okay. I was just struck by one point that you mentioned, that is, music is inherent. Do you feel that some people are naturally having the talent, and some people will be good musicians and some people will not be good musicians. Do you think that is something that is inherent? I just want to hear this from all of you. So how many of you feel that musical ability is innate? You can put your response in the chat box. Right, so the question for all of you is this. How many of you feel musical ability is innate, and some people will be good musicians if they are given an opportunity, and some people, they just don't have the talent for it, and no matter how much training you give, they will not become good musicians? Right. I can see a few responses, but yeah, I'll just give maybe a minute or two for you to think about it. Yeah, I'm curious to hear what all of you think. So all of you, you are free to share your thoughts. Right. So I can see from the responses that a lot of you think it's innate. Some people just are naturally gifted musically. They have the sense for music. But I can also see some people share this view that it is also a matter of training. So some people feel that innate musical ability might be there, but the training that you give, that will have more effect. So I can see that Deepali, for example, is sure that it's not, musical ability is not innate. Yeah, fine. Yeah, at this point, I also don't have any authority to say whether music is innate or not. I mean, I am just a lay person when it comes to music, like everyone else. So yeah, I don't think anyone has the authority to say that music is inherent or not inherent. But yeah, I just wanted to hear what you all felt. Right. I have another question. So here, the book was actually Mathematician's Lament, and for some reason, the author is talking about music. He opens his book with this nightmare about music. I just have this question for you. How many of you feel that music should be mandatory? You can put your answer in chat. How many of you feel music should be mandatory? And how many of you feel that maths should also be mandatory? Maybe I'll just put it in the chat also. Right. So yeah, again, I can see people with different views. Some people say that they should be mandatory. Some people say they shouldn't be mandatory. Right, so again, the point of this exercise is not to say that this is the correct answer. This is really just a space for us to express our views. So yeah, it's okay whatever opinion that you might have. At the end of the day, all of this is just opinion. So we cannot like scientifically say that these will be the benefits of or maybe we can say scientifically that these are the benefits of music or these are the benefits of maths. But our question is, do you think everyone should learn maths? Do you think everyone should learn music? So that was a question. And some of you feel, yeah, all students should be exposed to music. All students should be exposed to math. And some people say that, no, it's really up to the student. They should have a choice. So yeah, it's really a matter of our opinion. And yeah, we should just be open to hear all kinds of opinions. Right. So there are some responses which are kind of interesting. So when it becomes mandatory, the word kind of carries this notion of force, of having the students do something that they are not enjoying. So if I remove the word mandatory, it would be a question of, should all children be exposed to music and math? I think many of you are open for that. Many of you think that all students, all children should know a little bit of math. Not know, but at least be exposed to math or music or art of any kind. Right. So here, I just want to share a little anecdote, which happened in my college, in IISc. As in every college, there will be a first year orientation, and there was a graph which was shown in that orientation. So I just want to share that graph with you. Right. So I hope the screen is visible to everyone. Right. So in the orientation for research students in the first sem, on the first day, there's the orientation program, and the head of the department of computer science, he gave a presentation and he shared this particular visual, and he was explaining the importance of research. Right. So I come from IISc, which is kind of known for its research. That's what that is specialized. The institution is specialized in. So there he shared.
Ashwin.
Yeah.
Ashwin, is it possible to put the slide in the presentation mode?
Yeah. Sure. Sorry. Once again, it's gone back. Yeah, I have a little bit of a trouble switching across screens, so that's why it was. Yeah, okay. So I think there was a little bit of a trouble sharing the screen. Yeah, is it visible now, Shiv?
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. So during the orientation, this topic came up. That is, you could classify research in using two criteria. One was the abstraction of the work that you're doing, and the other was the utility of the work that you're doing. So here, you can have two axes. The x-axis is the utility of your research, and the y-axis is the abstraction. Abstraction could be like how complicated it is, how difficult or easy will it be for a lay person to understand your work. So he gave these three specific examples. The one on the bottom right corner is Thomas Edison. So he's well known for his work with electricity. He's kind of mostly famous for the invention of the light bulb, which is not entirely true, but he made lots of inventions, and he is known as, his work are known for a very great practical benefit to a lot of people, whether it's the light bulb or the phonograph or lots of other things. So that is something that benefits a lot of people. It is not overly technical, but still, I mean, obviously there is a lot of innovation there. There is a lot of original research and a lot of hard work that goes behind in his work. But there you have a research that gives practical benefits to many people. And on the top left, it's actually Niels Bohr. You may know him as the famous physicist. So Niels Bohr was fundamental in studying quantum physics. There were many great physicists at that time, and he was one of them who came up with this kind of very revolutionary idea of quantum physics. But for an average lay person, it seems very difficult to understand his work. It's very theoretical in nature, and you need to know a lot of physics background before you can even begin to understand his work. So it's a very, you could say it's a very complicated, his area of research was very complicated. And then, which is an intersection of these two areas, that is a kind of research that is, that has a lot of practical benefits to many people, and it's also very technically involved. For that, he gave the example of Louis Pasteur. Louis Pasteur is famous for his work in biology, but also he is famous for his work in chemistry. So his work spans across multiple disciplines. It's not just about physics and it's not just about chemistry and biology, but it's also about medicine. It's also about public health and lots of other things, even say nutrition, you could say. So it is not simple. It requires a lot of technical background to do that research, to understand that research, but it also benefits a lot of people. So in our current scenario, you could say working on the COVID vaccine. So that would be on the top right. So COVID vaccine is something that will benefit a lot of people, but it is not something simple. It is not something that anyone can just set up shop and make. It involves like rigorous scientific practice, rigorous study, and rigorous background knowledge and all of that. So he gave these three examples. So you have these three great people who are great researchers, who are great scientists, and your work should fall in one of these three quadrants. It should be of practical use. It should at least benefit a lot of people. Or it should be highly abstract and technical, and it should be earth-shattering. So something like quantum physics was truly revolutionary in physics. You could say the same about relativity. You could say the same thing about, say, smartphones when it comes to technology. Or it could be something like the COVID vaccine, which involves a lot of technical knowledge, and also it is of practical benefit. So he warned us, don't do research which falls in the fourth quadrant, where there's an empty hole, that is, which is simple and it is also useless. So he warned us, don't do research which falls in this category. Anyway, so I just, now that I have shared this idea as to how to measure research. So I worked in a computer science department. So there you could say the work is a lot of, say, software designing, coming with algorithms or making faster computers, things like that. So suppose you are teaching a different subject. Say you are teaching English. What would be the axis? So here for research, he chose the axis to be, the criteria to be practical benefit and abstraction. So if you are teaching, say, English, or say if you are teaching if you're teaching biology, how would you evaluate your subject now? So this was the question that I had asked earlier also. In fact, Shanti ma'am and Deepali, you had both shared your thoughts on that. But yeah, others, if you want, yeah, you can also share your thoughts now. So if I take a subject like, say, geography, how would you rate, what will be the criteria you use to evaluate geography? So geography will help you, say, map local terrain. Geography will help you, say, explore Antarctica. Or geography would help you, say, build a bridge across a river, for example. So if you are teaching a subject, what would be the criteria that you use to measure the quality of output in that subject? You can share your thoughts on chat, or I can share the Padlet link for you, and you can share your thoughts in the Padlet also. Let me share the Padlet link. Yeah, okay, maybe you can just share your thoughts on chat, or you can unmute yourself and speak. Okay, so I can see a few responses from Mrinal, Tarun, Shravan, Rashida. Yeah, so applicability. How applicable is it in life? Any subject teaching should be based on this. Yeah, Rashida ma'am, can you elaborate on that? I mean, you can unmute and speak if you want.
Yeah, hello.
Yeah, go ahead.
I teach science in the middle section, physics, chemistry, biology. So that is why I'm saying that science teaching should be always applicable. Means we have to see how it is applicable in life. Because science is totally life. Biology is life. Physics is what you are doing, whatever construction work or what, everything is life. So for that purpose only, I think application is the most important for any subject teaching. It can be a languages also, maths. Language is how you speak, how fluent you are. So that is what is language. Maths, how calculations will be done in day-to-day life, budgeting and all those things. So everywhere, application is important.
Okay.
That is what I want to say.
Yeah. Thank you, ma'am. Right. So how many of you would agree with Rashida ma'am? That is, whatever we teach, it has to be applicable. And yeah, and that will help students understand or be more engaged with that subject. So yeah, you can just put your answer in chat. So how many of you would rate applicability of that subject? Would that make a subject more appealing, or it makes it more useful? Right, so yeah, within this short span itself, I can see three different interesting answers. So I can see Shravan, he says applicability is not important. I can see Jagdish, who says, yes, he agrees, I hope, is it the applicability of the subject or with Shravan's opinion? So Gauri Satya, she feels that statistics is applicable, but it's not interesting, it's boring. Right, so Shiv says in subject like music, applicability doesn't come. Okay. Yeah. So any subject should be presented with focus on its utility. Yeah, Shilpa Rani. Shilpa Rani has shared her thoughts. Yeah, okay. Right, so at this point, now it's 5 o'clock. At this point, I just want to run a small experiment. It's basically just a small quiz, you could say. I will play a short music clip, and I would like you to identify this music. So you can just put your answer on chat. Right, so I'm just going to play a piece of music. I just want to see if you can identify this music. Let me share my I need to kind of set up So this is just meant to be maybe a little bit of a distraction. So how many of you can identify this music?
It's a Titan, Titan music something.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, you can put it on chat also if you want.
Okay.
Right, so everyone was able to identify this music from the Titan ad. Yeah, it's kind of an old ad. I heard it when I was very little. Yeah, most of you are able to identify this. Actually, as Gauri ma'am was pointing out, it's based on Mozart's symphony. I think it's based on 25th symphony. A lot of us don't may not be familiar with Mozart's work. We might not know that it's Mozart's 25th symphony, but we know it as the Titan watch ad music. Here is another clip that I want to play. It's actually not relevant to anything that we are doing, but still I want to play it because I like it so much. So let me share this piece of music with you. I will be really thrilled if you can also identify the composer of this music. Or let's see if you can identify this music, and I'll be doubly surprised if you can identify the composer of this music. So the minute, not even the minute, the second I started playing, I can see Tom and Jerry filling the chat box. But yeah, has anyone figured out who the music composer was for Tom and Jerry show? Right. Yeah, this is maybe like random trivia. But yeah, the music composer for the Tom and Jerry shows, at least for those Tom and Jerry shows, it was Scott Bradley. Yeah, I can see that Vivek also has got it. Yeah, it's not relevant to anything that we are doing. It is just a piece of music that I love that brings back old childhood memories. And yeah, all of us, we were able to identify this music, but obviously we didn't know the composer. It turns out to be Scott Bradley. But now, I want to run a poll with you. So, while we were discussing in the last 1 hour, we had this idea that a subject has to have some utility. So now I want to run a quick poll on Zoom, and you can just enter your option in Zoom. So there are three questions. It's about which invention came first. So I'll just call it the chicken and egg poll. So here are three questions. Which of the two inventions or discoveries was made first? You can vote your answer. So you have two. First question, it's about telephone and the planet Neptune. Which do you think was discovered or invented first? The second question is the continent of Antarctica and the radius of Earth. Which do you think people were able to find out first? And the third question is about non-Euclidean geometry and chloroform as an anesthetic. Which do you think people were able to find out first? Yeah, I will leave this poll open for a few minutes. Yeah, this is a random trivia quiz. So don't take it as like a challenge for your knowledge. It doesn't matter if you know the right answer or not. This is like random obscure things, which is not really, really important. It's not important that we are aware of all these things. This is just a fun exercise, that's all. Yeah, all of you are like joining me from a smartphone or a laptop. I hope you're not cheating, Googling it. Yeah, at least for now, the poll looks very interesting to me. I will. I think you are not able to see the result right now. I'll share the results like within a few seconds. So here, yeah, maybe I'll just give 10 seconds for those who haven't voted yet. You can still vote. Yeah, don't worry about whether your answer is right or not. That doesn't matter at all. I mean, like, unless you are specifically going and searching for these things, I don't think anyone will reasonably be expected to know the answer for these kind of random obscure questions. But anyway. Right. Now it's 2.5. I think I will end the poll here, and I will, I want to share the results with all of you. Right, is the answer visible to all of you? Right, can you all see how incredibly evenly split the answer is? For telephone and planet Neptune, it's 50-50. For Antarctica and radius of Earth, it's 56-44, little bit over there. For non-Euclidean chloroform, it's 50-50. It's like, I was running this poll. I mean, you are just seeing the answer now. I was looking at this for the last 20 minutes, last 2 minutes. And it was always 53-47, 58-42, like that. And now it ends at exactly 50-50. Right. So now, maybe I think it's time for me to give the answer. Right. Which of the two was found first, telephone or the planet Neptune? Telephone was invented around 1870s or so. That is when Alexander Graham Bell filed the patent for it. So it was in 1870. The planet Neptune was discovered in 1845, 46, around that time. So actually it turns out that the planet Neptune was discovered much before telephone was invented. And for the second question, which of the two was found first, the continent of Antarctica or the radius of Earth? Right, so the answer, the polling shows 56-44. The continent of Antarctica is reliably dated to have been discovered by James Cook, the British explorer, in around 1775 or so. Maybe someone might have gone there 2 years earlier, or they had seen the landmass but actually not set foot on that. All those things are there, but it is around late 18th century, you could say. The radius of Earth, it was calculated accurately within like 3% or something like that margin of error. It was calculated in 300 BC or so. So the radius of Earth was measured thousands of years or 1,500 years before people actually knew that there was a continent of Antarctica. And which of the two was first used, non-Euclidean geometry or chloroform as an anesthetic? So many of you, in case you don't know, non-Euclidean geometry is a different kind of geometry. So we are used to studying geometry on the piece of paper, right? We are drawing on a flat surface, but you could also draw on some kind of curved surface. And many scientists believe that our universe is actually not Euclidean. It's some kind of curved space. Our space itself is not flat. It is bent in some way. So non-Euclidean geometry was actually kind of hypothesized by Carl Friedrich Gauss, and it was developed by other mathematicians. All of this happened in 1820s or 1840s. It was fully written in a paper in sometime around 1820s. Chloroform was an anesthetic. Chloroform was prepared in 1820s, but it was used for surgery only in 1840 or so, 1847 or something like that. So though people knew chloroform, I mean, people had isolated the compound, they actually used it, they found a use for it much later, like some 15, 20 years later. They experimented on animals and then they found that, it's useful for, it's useful for humans also as an anesthetic during surgery, and they started using it. Right. So why did I ask these random questions, these random inventions which obscure dates which I cannot reasonably expect anyone to know? Why do you think I asked you this very weird poll? Okay. The point I was, the point I wanted to show.
Most of us might not have a deeper understanding. One mute.
Right. Okay. So I think because of the power cut, I think I'm having a little bit of a problem. Just one second. Right. I am sorry. I'm in darkness because the light was taking up too much of the battery charge, and I'm kind of running out of battery. But yeah. Right. So I wanted to show you that people were studying subjects. People are studying topics which had no immediate practical benefit, but still they spent a lot of time studying it. And the best example would be the telephone and Neptune. Neptune is a planet that is so far away. Even astrologers who feel planets have an influence of us, even they didn't know of Neptune. So it had absolutely no effect. No one knew it even existed, but it was discovered. And it was actually discovered using a little bit of math. So people studied the orbit of Uranus, they noticed that there was some kind of anomaly there. It was not going as predicted. So they predicted that there will be another big planet next to Uranus, and it will be in this position in this time. They were able to make the calculations, and when they pointed the telescope, they were able to find the new planet there. So this, I cannot see any practical benefit for us for discovering a new planet. And at that time, it was very far away. It was not going to be colonized. There is no chance for that and all of that. And telephone, which is kind of a revolutionary piece of invention, that was discovered only 30 years later. So if these great minds who had spent so much time in discovering Neptune, if they had put their mind to it, they could have invented the telephone 30 years earlier. Humanity would have benefited so much. But then they spent their time looking at the night sky. Right. So at least the point that I'm trying to convey is, a lot of times it's not the practical utility that motivates people to study something, but people study something for its own sake because they like the challenge or because they find it beautiful or something like that. So I played these two music clips. These music clips, they don't have any immediate practical value. You could make money as a musician, but most people, they are not successful musicians. They don't make a lot of money out of that. But still, many people love music anyway. So why do they spend so much time studying music or playing music, even though if they cannot make money out of it, even if it's not going to make them popular or anything? And it's the same reason that a lot of people study maths or science. So I just want to share a quick activity with you. We are running out of time and I'm also running out of battery. So I'll just have this quick 2-minute activity with all of you. Let me share my screen. Right. So I just want to share this bit of math puzzle with you. I have 2 points and I want you to find out all the points which you should choose a point such that if you draw the angle from these 2 points to that point, it should be 30 degrees. So if you find all the points, what will it look like? I will share the screen so that it's easier for you to understand.
Do you want me to share the screen if that saves you a bit?
Yeah, fine. Mrinal, you can share the screen. You can go to the slide on activity. That's slide number 9.
You need to enable screen share.
Yeah, 1 second. Yeah, you should be able to do it now.
not happening.
Okay, fine. I'll share it. It's okay. No problem. No, it's okay. I will be able to share. Yeah, I think now it's up. Right. So I have these two points and I want to find all the different points so that it will form a 30 degree angle. Now the question is, what do you think all the points will look like? Will it be like some random scattered, there'll be many points, or will it be some kind of a straight line? Will it be a line parallel to the two points, or it'll be some kind of slanting line, or what do you think the shape would be? I'll give you 2 minutes. Yeah, you can just put your answer in chat. Again, this is not to test your mathematical ability or something. It's just a fun exercise for us to do. That's all. So the question is, you have 2 points and you choose a third point so that it forms 30 degrees. If you have many such points, what will all those points together look like? Okay, so I can see a couple of answers. Hemant says it's a cone. Deepa says it's a circle. Right. Maybe I'll... Okay, so the angle is created on the top. So you are able to see different triangles, right? So the angle is the angle that I'm talking about is the top of the triangle, the tip. Right. So yeah, I'm getting different responses. Hemant, he now believes that it's not going to be a cone. Okay, some of you are saying circle, some of you are saying triangle, ellipse, whatever. What if I told you that you already know the answer? You studied it in school. I'm assuming that all of you have studied at least till 10th standard. What if I told you that you actually studied this in your maths geometry in class 10? I think it should be in class 10 or maybe sometime. But anyway, you have all studied this. Right. So let me give you the answer.
I think Ashwin has run out of the battery. So, Shravan Shiv, anyone of you would like to take it forward?
Okay, I guess Ashwin's battery is dead. Yeah, so the answer to this would be I see many as a circle, ellipse, triangle, sphere. But one key idea behind this is in a circle, the angle on the circle is half the angle in the center. Right? So see if you can make use of this fact. So if you want the angle on the circle to be 30 degrees, then the angle in the center should be 60 degrees. So if you try to form a circle, if you try to form an appropriate circle so that the angle between these two points and the center is 60 degrees, and then if you test out all the points, what shape would it be? So it'll be a part of a circle. So it'll be like a major secant of a
exact word. I do not know. I'm not kidding.
So it is the major portion of the circle. That's the answer. The major arc. Yeah. I guess this is what Ashwin had in his mind. I think we can. Okay, so 3D. Yeah, so 3D part, I do not know, I have to think. Any answers about 3D? Anyone? So I saw a 3D, yes, cone. I saw code, someone said cone. Might be a possibility. I don't know. I'll have to think and get back. Okay, let me think and cook. Yeah, that's a nice, like a cucumber.
Would it be a part of a sphere?
Of a sphere. I don't know. I have to give some thought.
Okay, so I'm back. I'm sorry.
Okay.
Am I audible? Are you able to see me?
Yeah.
Yes, you are audible.
Yeah, okay. I'm really sorry. I have this unfortunate accident. The power has gone off exactly when the session was going on. Anyway, so Shiv, have you explained the answer to everyone?
Yeah. So in 2D, I have said that the answer is the major portion of the circle.
Yeah.
First of all, am I right?
Yes.
But then the follow-up question was, what about in 3D?
Yeah.
And Hemant had a guess that it would be a cone. So I didn't have any opinion on that.
Yeah. Okay. Thanks, Shiv. Can you share the next slide? So this was the point that I was trying to make with the question or with this activity. That is, we often tend to say a subject would be interesting if it's applicable to real life. And that argument has a lot of validity, because a lot of what we teach our students, it has no immediate benefit for them. It's not applicable to them in their day-to-day life. But as adults, we can see a value in it. It is useful for different aspects of our life. It gives us the different skills and so on. But for children, especially for young children, they don't see the value in applicability. They don't see how it will benefit them later. Even if it benefits them to get a good job, if you get good marks in maths and physics or something like that, it will help you get a good job. That's what motivates the students. So what will motivate the students is the surprises that you have in your subject, the surprises that we have in a particular topic, and also the beauty that is there in the topic. This activity that we did, it is part of the curriculum that we have all come across. We have all studied this, but we don't remember. This particular activity of finding the angle, it probably does have some benefit. It's probably there in say estimating the height of a mountain or something like that. It does have its application in engineering or something like that. But then you had this music I played earlier, that is the Titan theme song or the Tom and Jerry music, which we were all able to instantly recognize. We didn't know the technical aspects of it, but still we are able to remember those things which had no practical benefit for us. And something which has benefit for us, which we have seen, which we are supposed to know, for which we were evaluated, it's still something that has left our minds. So the point I'm trying to make is this. When we are trying to appeal to children or students of any age, the utility, it is something they will find, they will realize later. That does not appeal to them in the present classroom. And that is the reason a lot of students don't get motivated by the subjects, the topics, or the way we teach. But as Paul Lockhart actually says, this is from his book, the beauty and the surprises in a subject, that motivates the students. That impacts the students in the present at whatever level they are. Mrinal, can you go on to the next slide? Right. So here, There is a BBC article. I will share the link to the research article also maybe later. So here is an article which shows how the brain recognizes the beauty in maths. This was, of course, this was actually a proper scientific study where mathematicians were shown different equations and they were asked to rate the beauty of it. Of course, if someone is someone for a non-mathematician, for a lay person who does not know all these equations, it will not make sense. It will just be a random bunch of symbols. That is okay. But for mathematicians who knew the symbols and so on, they could understand what they were seeing. The cognitive parts of their brain were lit up. I mean, all of the mathematicians were asked to look at different equations and they were put under this fMRI. But apart from the knowledge part of their brain which lit up, the beauty part of their brain, that is the part that recognizes beauty, the beauty which would be in music or in a painting or a sculpture or a piece of literature, whatever emotional responses would trigger, these equations trigger the same responses in the mathematician, in different mathematicians. And they actually repeated this in a different phase, in on different subjects. So it was not just I hope I'm audible now. Right. So even when professionals of different fields, when they were asked to look at pieces of work from their domain, the beauty, the part of their brain which recognizes beauty, that also lit up for them. Manal, can you go on to the next slide? Thanks. So this was the original paper, which is quoted in the article that I just shared. So the experience of mathematical beauty and its neural correlates. Of course, it's a technical paper, but still, there is an inherent beauty in subjects that we teach, and exposing this beauty to the students, that helps them understand the subject better. Although as teachers, our aim is to get them understand the content, also develop the skills and so on. But appealing to the beauty, and that alone is sufficient for them to engage with the subject. Manal, can you go on to the next slide? Right. So this is, of course, Euler's formula. Many of you may be familiar with it, but for those who are not familiar, this was, you could say, invented or discovered either way, but Euler was the first one to put it in this form. There were parts of it mathematicians had known earlier also, but Euler was the one who wrote this particular statement, e power I pi plus 1 equal to 0. And this has been rated as the most beautiful equation in maths. And this was rated by mathematicians of different sizes. So for those of us who are mathematicians, looking at this, it would give them extreme joy or it will make them euphoric and so on. For others, yeah, it is just a bunch of symbols. But for mathematicians, they see something that is so inspiring in it, which once you know the technical details, you are able to appreciate it. But still, nevertheless, there is something in this statement, which is just a bunch of symbols, that appeals to mathematicians and it makes them go really crazy over this. I am sure every subject will have something similar to this. Again, this beauty is subjective. It is not to say that only this is beautiful and all the other equations are not beautiful. No, that is not the point. The point is this. There is a beauty in your subject which some people are able to intuitively grasp. And appealing to that beauty, that would be a good motivation for students to learn. So Manal, can you go on to the next slide? So mathematics was, of course, about math teaching, but as I said, it's up to obvious of all subjects. The common lament of teachers is this. That is, the kids don't want to learn. They don't understand that what they are studying now will help them later. And they don't understand that all of these skills are important to make a living, to get a job, to get to secure a good, stable life. But of course, that's because the students, the kids, they don't see far into the future. They want to be excited right now in the classroom, in the present. So how do we overcome all these limits? Paul Lockhart and lots of other educators also give this idea. That is, you change it into delight. Kids don't want to learn, but they want to play. So give them something that they can play with. And whatever surprises or beauty that you have in your subject, show that to the students first. And all the technical aspects of the particular topic or subject, that can come later, as we kind of discussed earlier also in this meeting. And yeah, even if something has no utility, it is possible that it might have its own beauty, its own value, independent of its application. If you're able to reach that, if you're able to convey that to students, then we will not have a problem where the students are not paying attention in the classroom. Students don't see the value in the subject. So all of these problems can be overcome if you take a different approach. Of course, this is my opinion. So this is the opinion of Paul Lockhart, and I kind of agree with him. Great. So I think it would be interesting at this point to hear from you. I think I'll just stop talking for a little bit. For 10 minutes, I think we'll have an open discussion to hear what are your thoughts, and then we can conclude the session. Mrinal, I'm joining from phone. Would it be possible for you to moderate?
Sure. Yeah, maybe you can all share your thoughts on chat or raise your hand or unmute. So Ashwin, maybe I can ask you a question. So you talked about looking for beauty, right? But maybe as a mathematician, it's intuitive for you to look for beauty. How should anyone go about looking for beautiful topics or beautiful aspects of the subject?
Right. I am just a layperson, so I'm not any expert on aesthetics or beauty or things like that. I do believe in this. If you love a subject, it's not necessary that everyone should love maths or everyone should love music or a particular subject. Whatever subject that you are teaching or you are passionate about, you will be able to find something beautiful over there. And I really have no method to identify what is beautiful or not. I think it's kind of intuitive and it's very subjective. But I do believe that if there is anything that is worth communicating, that is worth teaching to students and so on, there should be something beautiful in that. And that is something the teacher and the student will be able to recognize instinctively. Because I have studied math and I spend a lot of time thinking about math, I was able to come up with this example. I'm sure someone else teaching a different subject, they will also be able to come with something beautiful in their subject. Because I don't have the expertise right now, I cannot give an example in the other subject. But in my own subject, I will be able to, if I believe that it is something worthwhile, I will be able to find something beautiful. This is just a plain foolhardy notion, which I cannot really prove or anything, but this is something I strongly believe.
Yeah, I would just, maybe open the floor to anyone if you want to add anything about this aspect or anything else, it would be nice to share. Just to the aspect of beauty, maybe I would like to add that maybe it's not the concept that is beautiful, but appreciation of going through that process and finding something about that concept could be beautiful, or that could be some other way of looking the beauty in the subject. So it could be process of finding things out, which can also be beauty, or it could be beautiful. Yeah, someone is saying that, yes, Deepali ma'am is saying that joy of learning can be a baby step. Yeah, I think I agree that, reaching or connecting with students and letting them experience the joy of learning could be a wonderful way to engage them. So convert, that could be one step in educator's delight. Shilpa says, sometimes passionate teachers can show the beauty to the students. Yes, I agree. Pankaj, you had raised your hand.
Yeah, so I just want to know your opinion. Maybe Ashwin, you can also share. So see, there is one thing where we talk about this beauty. On the other side, we also have a lot of constraints, especially in the school classroom, teacher has a lot of constraints. So where does one strike a balance over here? Because they have, everybody has to finish the syllabus. Then there are, Tarun mentioned about these outcomes. So where do we strike some balance between appreciating the beauty of that? It is definitely delightful to learn anything, music, math, or anything else. But there are other constraints imposed by whomever. I don't know. I don't want to go over there. But where do we see this balance?
My opinion would be, I don't have a magic bullet answer. I don't have a magic bullet that will solve this problem. I think given the constraints, we should find some way of communicating the beauty. So not every class, every topic needs to be taken in this way, but at least once in a while, at least give the students a short glimpse of this. That would be my answer. So I know that this is not a perfect answer. I mean, we are all in this together and we all face the same challenges. Maybe a little bit. So if we at least believe in the beauty of the subject and show a little glimpse, not all the time, that would be the ideal case. And if that happened, that would be great. But that is not practical. But once in a while, if we are able to allocate some time, some fraction of our class for this, maybe not every class, but at least once in a while regularly, if we are able to expose the students to this way of thinking, I think that would be a place to start at least.
Right. Yeah, any other questions for Ashwin or any comments that you would like to make?
Yeah, so I can see this response from Hemant. What if the student has already made up his mind that math is not his cup of tea? How to change that? Yeah, that is actually a good question. So again, it is like, I am not in a position of authority to say that I have the clear answer for this and this works and so on. For the student who has made up their mind that they are not interested in math, my solution would be to find out what they are interested in and have this integration of math and that topic of interest. Yeah, this is a very ideal response in a very ideal utopian world where we have a lot of time and we can expend that effort on that student. I would say if I were facing this problem, I don't know how much it will work, but my way of approaching this situation would be to see what the student will be interested in. So say if it's cricket, I would see how I can show them that maths is actually there in cricket in some way. Or say if the student is interested in music, there is actually math in music also. Of course, I am not a trained musician, so I cannot, I don't understand what is the technicality, what is the maths involved over there. But I am sure that as other teachers also pointed out, other educators pointed out earlier in this session, that there is a lot of integration along whatever our experiences are in life, all our challenges, all the solutions. It is only for the convenience of having a timetable that we have split all this knowledge into different subjects. You teach this subject from 9 to 9:30 and the other subject from 9:30 to 10. But life is not like that. So I would say that have some topic which will interest the students and show where your topic, say whether it's English or geography or maths, where that is coming, where that is fitting in your topic. So because this came up, I'll just give this quick example, which just came off the top of my head. So say you are teaching geography. There is this idea of, there is this topic of soil in geography. It's probably there in science also, in lower classes, but whatever. That is actually there in cricket. In cricket, you have different pitches, and different pitches behave differently because of what is there in the soil content. So you have Australia, where all the wickets are bouncy. It's because they have a lot of grass. And you have India, you have a test match in Chennai, where there's a lot of spin, because in India, we have very dry wickets. There's a lot of science, there's a lot of chemistry, there's a lot of geography involved here. And the reason that you have dry pitches here is the same reason that you grow rice in particular parts of the country. It's the same reason that you grow cotton in particular parts of the country. Now, if you explain anyone why we should grow more cotton, or why this climate is suited for cotton, I don't know how many students will be engaged with that. But if you tell them, you see how the ball is turning in this pitch. This is happening because of this reason, because of the moisture content. It is the same moisture content that affects what grows here. So the same reason that your bike or car skids when you move too fast, that is the same reason you have storms, you have cyclones. Of course, it's a huge extrapolation. It's a huge jump. It's not an analogy at all. But still, it's a good trigger. It's a good place to start to engage the student. That would be my opinion on this problem. That is how to engage with someone who has already made up their mind that they're not interested in the subject. Right, so it's 5:45 now. And I'm really sorry about all the inconveniences. There was a lot of issues here. There was power cut. I really apologize for that. And I am sorry for taking up 15 minutes more of your time. But I just wanted to end this session at this point. I would love to hear more from you, but because we're kind of out of time, I will just want to briefly conclude. So this Teacher's Corner, it is meant to be a place where we have an exchange of ideas, and we are having this every month on the third Tuesday at 4:00. Next session, it will be on March 16th, and of course we will share the link and the topics with you soon. We want to keep this an open platform, so if you are interested in discussing a particular topic or a particular aspect of pedagogy, you are more than welcome to actually take the session. So this will be an open space for you. If you want, you can also take a topic, or you can suggest some topics which you want to discuss, and we will try to take it up in the future sessions. So I think I'll just stop here. Thank you for your time. Thank you for your attention. I hope I was able to just put forth my idea of discovering the beauty in a subject. And we could have a longer conversation right now, or maybe over chat in the WhatsApp group or on the Padlet also. So thank you again for attending. If you have any more questions, you can stay back. Others, thanks for attending. You are free to leave now if you want.
Hi, Gauri here. I have a question. So forgetting all practical considerations, what is the ideal utopian scenario where everyone is, where you're learning to appreciate the beauty and you're going by your interests or inclinations?
Mm-hmm.
How does that work? What is the ideal learning? I mean, what does that look like? Forgetting all practical considerations, what does it look like?
Okay, so most of the ideas that I shared, it's really coming out of Paul Lockhart's book. That was specifically meant for school education, but I guess his way of looking at the world, and probably which would be shared by a lot of idealists, would be that everyone pursues what they like, and they are not hampered by the environment or the practical considerations. So if you have a student who is interested in math, they will learn at their own pace. they will make their own discoveries. So they will not have formulas handed over to them. Say, for example, the area of a triangle. I think that is taught in some class 7. If the student never feels the need to learn the area of a triangle, we don't give it to him. We don't give it to him or her. But for some reason, if the student is interested in calculus, although it's an advanced topic, you allow them to explore the topic of calculus. It doesn't matter that it involves a kind of advanced. So basically, every student is allowed an opportunity to explore the subject for themselves, to experience the beauty for themselves. And the role of a teacher is just to pose them problems and leave them alone. If they are struggling with it for weeks together or months together, that's fine. If the student wants to continue with that problem, that's okay, you just allow them. If they are frustrated and if they give up, then also it's fine. Or at least that is the idea that the author was sharing. That is, even if the student is frustrated and he doesn't want to work on the problem, okay, fine, you just give him a different problem, that's all. So others, you are free to share your thoughts also. If you have ideas which you don't agree with, or you have specific suggestions, you can go ahead and share them with us right now.
Yeah, maybe we can all think on meta level and try to find out what makes us find something beautiful or appreciate the beauty of something. That might give ideas for someone to understand how to find beautiful things. Yeah, honestly, I don't know. If you ask me, I don't know what is beautiful in my subject. I can maybe tell you many interesting things, but I wouldn't call them beautiful or...
I mean, that's a fair point. And when you ask me how to find beauty, I don't have an answer for that either. I don't have a method to say that this is beautiful and this is not beautiful. Actually, I wanted to share the video clip also on assessing the beauty in a poetry. But because of all these technical issues that cropped up in between, I wasn't able to share that video with you. Maybe I'll share that video and all the other links over the WhatsApp group with everyone. Right. Maybe beauty would not be the right word. It could be what inspires you about this subject. It could be that you have this subject which is able to uplift many people. Or it is able to say cure many diseases, or say at a very simple way, I like stand-up comedy because it brings a smile to people. So in that way, there is something about that job or the task or that subject which will inspire someone to take it up of their own will. And if you are in a situation where you are doing something where you don't believe it is worthwhile, then I think it's a sorry, unfortunate state of affairs. Of course, lots of us have different compulsions, and not everyone lives in a very ideal world. But still, if you are in a place where you are studying a subject which does not appeal to you, you don't see any use in it, it doesn't inspire you, it's okay. I mean, if you're not able to define the beauty, that is okay. I am not able to define the beauty in math either. But still, if there is nothing that interests you, if there's nothing that holds your attention in that subject, then I think we don't have the aptitude for that subject. And I feel it's very hypocritical if you don't believe in that subject and you ask your students to believe in that subject. That is my opinion, of course.
Thank you so much for the session, though. Actually, we were talking more on technical terms in the beginning, and thank you so much for that, though. But can we have another session which would be a follow-up on how of it as well? You know, what has happened is that past so many years we are into the technical aspects of teaching, right? Mm-hmm. And now if when you were talking about how Neptune was discovered, mm-hmm. at that point of time there were not many formal schools, or even many inventors or scientists have never been to those kind of formal education. They have not been exposed.
Mm-hmm.
If you look, and that's an irony because they have never been into that system. They mm-hmm. have just been exposed. I just read Tarun's comment that exposure and something was there, and it actually hit me. I was just writing about it. So can we have another session on how of it as well? How do we facilitate? How do we empower ourselves to facilitate our students? Yes, as someone just mentioned, we are in kind of system where, you know, there are a lot of things, mechanisms that we have to follow in the classroom.
Yeah.
Within that, how do we empower our students to find their love? Right? Something that they want to research or they want to go ahead with.
Yeah, that's a very interesting question. And I think I don't have an answer right now, but I think it's a good discussion to have. And we can definitely have a session where we take up the point that you mentioned just now, the how of it, how to facilitate this to students. Yeah, I mean, I don't have the answer right now, but yeah, I will definitely think about this question and
fine, because even I am trying to write down. Now, for example, I have you studied computer science, right?
Mm-hmm.
And you're into teaching. A similar thing happened with me. I did astrophysics and I came to teaching.
Wow. Okay.
So that actually, you know, you relate to some things.
Mm-hmm.
You acquire some things and you learn. There's a difference between acquiring and learning.
Yeah.
Right? So when we're trying to facilitate that passion, now even if you learned something technically, you're passionate about teaching, and that is the reason you're not into the system, though you're trying to recapitulate the system right now. I'm talking about the education system here, essentially. So it is really, and if we are in a part of such community where we are meeting and we are trying to share that space and get such individuals who want to do it, then we also need to figure out small steps, baby steps of how to do it. And because otherwise it will not give a closure to us, what we're thinking.
Yeah, that is true.
I'm not looking for an answer right now. I'm just putting my thoughts about the session across to everyone who's present here.
Yeah, I mean, that is what this place is for. It is to have this exchange of ideas and come up with different solutions for all the challenges that we are facing. I think it's a really worthwhile discussion to have, and we should definitely have it sometime.
One of our future sessions may be something around this line. So in fact, it will be good if you can also join, like some of us and you, and we like jointly conduct one such session on the how of it. Deepali, yeah.
Sorry, you were saying something?
No, I'm saying that it would be good, like we can jointly work out a session on the how of it, what you just...
Sure, it would be really a pleasure, because, you know, we all need to figure out a way out of it, right?
Correct.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Ashwin. Thank you so much, everyone else.
Yeah, thanks for joining us today. I think we will end this meeting here right now. It's almost 6 o'clock. So yeah, I would like to share all the links to the articles and all of those things in the WhatsApp group. We will keep the WhatsApp group open at least for a little bit to hear from you. And
question to ask.
Yeah.
Sir, I want some links for math as an art. I want some links, sir. Can you send me the examples?
I will post it on the WhatsApp group for this teacher's corner. And I'll post some of them.
Thank you.
Yeah, in particular, I want to share the e-book also with you, The Mathematician's Layman, which we just read the first few pages of it. I think I'll share that book with you, and that will be helpful for most of you. Okay, then I think it's time to end this meeting. So yeah, I hope to see all of you again for the next session, which will happen on March 16th. So yeah, thanks for joining. Thanks for spending the time with us. Hope to see you again for the next session. Yeah, bye.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.